Praise the Lord. You just do it just because. Or some people, they just come because you want a place to hang out. But that's not it. I want you to look at the promise that you promised God. I want to see the beauty that was there in heaven when they say, we're going to grant this person a visa so that he can come and serve God. And through that, God made a covenant that he's going to elevate you. Praise the Lord. He's going to elevate your name. He's going to establish you so that you can be able to be great. Same thing with somebody that was earning $200. You pray, and the Lord saw your cry, he saw your tears. And the Lord says, I am going to blow your mind, I'm going to bless you indeed. And from 200 you went to school, the Lord continued to bless you, you cried through your school, and the Lord saw it faithful. And then, when you got your first check, or like when you went, you got your first job, they said, this is how much we're going to be giving you. And you look at the figure, you say, are you talking about per year or per month? Are you talking about per year or per month? And they say, no, this is an hour. Praise the Lord. This is how much we're going to be giving you an hour. So you calculate per week, this is how much you're going to be taking home. And if you calculate per month, this is how much you're going to be taking home. And they are not laughing. They say, yeah. Amen. And now, it comes the hardest part. Pastor come and say, please bring your 10% to the house of God. And you look at Pastor Polo, you say, 10% of how much? You calculate. You use a calculator because you cannot calculate with a way. You say, 10% of bring to the church, to JICC. JICC. Even you look at it, Jake, where? Then who? Let me tell you, when you do that, the covenant in heaven is still looking. The covenant at the altars in heaven, they are still looking. They say, okay, so you are so contented with that, you cannot be able to give 10%. And the Lord says, you don't know how much you are blocking your blessings. Amen? Amen. Because the same amount that muffled you, if you bring 10% to the house, you don't know, maybe 5 years from now, the Lord is planning to relocate you from that location and move you to another place. That instead of lighting that check of $2,000 that you see like it's a Lord, the Lord wants you to be lighting a check of $20,000 or $50,000 because he's faithful. Praise the Lord. But we have limited ourselves so much. Praise the Lord. Let me go back to my preaching. Praise the Lord. That was only on Tuesday. Now come Wednesday. This is where the matter of the whole thing was. I came here on Wednesday night. And when I came here for prayers, I reminded people that on a Wednesday was a very challenging day for Jesus. Because this was the day that one of the men that has walked with Jesus in the ministry, he had seen Jesus performing miracles. He had seen it all in the ministry. He was one of the 12 disciples of Jesus, his name was Judas. When Jesus was busy in the temple, when Jesus was busy in the ministry, Judas was out there making deals. How many know that there are some church folks? When everybody is down here at the altar watching me, they are out there making deals. And I'm not talking about good deals. I'm talking about making deals to even to close in the end to sell Jesus. Betrayal. They are church folks that has betrayed the church. When everybody is worshiping, you are busy there gossiping. When everybody is there crying to the Lord, Judas was out there making deals. He was negotiating. He was like, how much? I said, no, give me some more. You know, that's a big job, you know, because they're going to all have the same outfit, you know, they have hats, and you know, I have to approach it in a way that I don't want everybody to know, you know, and there's a way that I'm going to kiss him, and when I see that, I'm going to be pointing to you at the back over there. We have our own sign, so you know, you have to have some money on this. So that's the kind of deal that Judas was making. And they said, it's okay. Amen? So they made a deal. And Jesus, because he's all-knowing, he is God. He knew that was happening on Wednesday. And he told them when they got together with the disciples, he said, you know what, guys? I think one of you, has made a deal to betray me. They were like, no, Jesus, it cannot be me. And they were like, no, I don't think it's you. Thomas was still sitting down there quietly. I don't think so. And of course, you know, Peter was like, no, it cannot be me. And Jesus said, you know what? You don't even have to wait until the betrayal. Because the minute that we're going to be eating the bread here, when I put my hand, we'll be putting the hand together. And that moment when they were doing that, Judas and Jesus, they put the hand together. And they look at each other. And Jesus knew, and Judas knew that, you know, it's me. But he, of course, he couldn't say anything. Praise the Lord. What am I trying to say? When the Lord has anointed you, when the Lord has called you, we need to get rid of spirit of Judas in the house. You need to get rid of spirit of Judas in your life. There are people you love together. You hang out together. There are people. Everything you do together, they know all your secrets. But the minute you leave there, they turn their back. They are the same people that are stabbing you at the back. I know you guys don't want me to preach about these things on an Easter Sunday. But that's the kind of world that we are living with. They are your co-workers. They are your friends. You hang out. You eat together. You do potluck together. They tell you how much they love your cooking. Hallelujah. And the minute you leave, they're the same people. Come here, you worship. You come here, we lay hands, pass up praise on you. And then you leave out of there.
Did you see how he was preaching?
Did you see what he was wearing? What is that now? Looking cheap, you know? Not in JSC, but I'm just saying this happened, you know? You see, those things, they happen in the world that we are living in. Praise the Lord. Do I have the authority to preach about this? Yes. Hallelujah. Because our sister Jackie here told us on Friday night, he said that Peter, and now we are going to Thursday, after betrayal, she said that now Peter was full of power and he had told Jesus that he's going to protect him. Yeah. Praise the Lord. And when he came to Thursday, before Peter, you know, because when they came to Thursday, Jesus told the disciples, we are going to have a Passover, because it was now the custom. Everybody in Jerusalem at that particular day, on that day, they had to eat the Passover meal together. So they were gathering together as families, they were gathering together as friends, and they could eat the dinner together, remembering their Passover from Egypt. Are we together? Are we together?
Yes.
Now, Jesus, it was so good for him to be together with his disciples, to eat together. And so when they were eating together, Jesus, he took the bread and he broke the bread and he said, this is my body that has been blood for me. And he broke it. And the minute he broke it, he gave it to the disciples and they all ate. And after he has finished, he gave them the cup and he drank and he told them that this is going to be the cup of new covenant. But let me tell you, when Jesus was telling them that, they were all thinking about the Passover. But Jesus was telling them that the bread now that you're thinking about is not that. feeds me, my body here, this body now is the bread. My blood will be the blood of the new covenant. So he was telling them that whatever you are seeing me doing over here, it's going to be your lifestyle from today. It's going to be me. Praise the Lord. Some of them could not understand. But Peter was full of revelation and he was just moving everywhere because he could hear something in his heart. He was burning, something was burning, and he was like, Christ, I'm ready. Whatever it takes, I'm ready to protect you. So they did that on Thursday. And now when it came Friday, now Judas had already completed his mission. And now it was time for them to come and get him. And when they came, and Judas' deal was complete, he successfully did his mission. Then Peter. So the soldiers who came to arrest Jesus. And Peter was like, hey, you know what? This cannot happen on my watch. He took up his knife. And according to our sister Jackie, she said on Friday that when Peter took the knife, he cut the ear of the soldier. But our sister said that I don't think Peter was aiming at the ear. Why would he aim at the ear? No. This was a dead, life and death situation. He was aiming at the head. Because he was declared, this is the time for battle now. No turning back. But when he aimed at the head, he missed. He caught the ear and he chopped the ear. And Jesus said, no, brother. We are not fighting physical. This is not physical. He took the ear and said, can you put it back? He put it back. And the guy saw the ear. He didn't have a sense to continue to arrest me. If I'm the one and my ear is cut and then I see it, I will run away from that mission. He could not see. He was so focused, he was so blinded. And then revelation number two, our sister said that when you go ahead, because Peter now he went ahead of Jesus, he could have asked the instruction from Jesus. But she said, when you go ahead of Jesus, what do? You miss the head. So when you go ahead of Jesus, you miss the head. And there are so many people who have missed the head because they have gone ahead of Jesus. Have you feel, when you look at your life and see some of the things that you have failed in life, it's because you have gone ahead of Jesus. You say, Jesus, you said it's going to happen, but I want to go ahead and do it anyway. You pray for something. Before you receive your confirmation, you go ahead and grab it. I don't want to preach much because our sister said it all. Praise the Lord. He said how some people grab their miracles half-baked. Because they went ahead and they missed the head. Praise the Lord. That was on Friday. So and they went and crucified Jesus. And they went home. You all know about the story of crucifixion. They went home successfully and happy that they have done it all. They have silenced him and this is done. And that's why the whole of Sunday was quiet. Because they have said, this man has troubled us for 3.5 years. Now we've silenced him. There's nothing, we don't want to hear about him anymore. Ladies and gentlemen, when they silence you, when they think that everything about you is quiet, just tell them that you are searching for the power. Jesus himself, when they silence him, when they see you quiet, they think that everything about you is over. But how many know that when they silence you, you are recharging yourself. You are getting ready. You are gearing yourself up for the run. Praise the Lord. When you see me quiet, ladies and gentlemen, I'm not quiet because I've come to the end of myself. I am quiet because I'm getting ready for the next season. I am getting ready for the next breakthrough. I am getting ready for the next thing that the Lord is just about to do in my life. When you see been quiet. I am not quiet because I'm in silence. I am quiet because I'm looking for strategies. Praise the Lord. I am quiet because I'm telling the enemy that the Bible says that some of these demons cannot go on with my prayers. They require my fasting. I am silent because I'm in fasting. But I'm getting ready. I am gearing myself up because I'm just about to take another land. Hallelujah. When they see you quiet, when they see you quiet, they think you are ignorant. But you're telling them that I'm quiet because my next phase, my next season, it will require a seed of greatness in me to emerge. So I have to approach it in greatness. Praise the Lord. So that's what happened on Saturday. And the Bible says, I like how John put it in book in the book of John, chapter number 20. Now after Saturday, everything and everyone was tired, and everyone was like, what happened? They didn't know what else to do. If you can put for me John 20, verse number 1. Bible says, now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb early while it was still dark and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. Then she ran and came to Simon Peter and to the other disciple whom Jesus loved, and that's John, and said to them, They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him. And I want you to see, it was so ironical that the first people that went to the grave very early in the morning was women. And you expect the men to be there very early in the morning. But as you know from the book of Genesis, Adam has been missing in action. Even when God came to the garden to look for Adam, the first question he said, Adam, where are you? He could not find Adam. And if God could not find Adam in the garden, why do we expect that we can find Adam in church? Why do we find Adam? Why do we expect that we can find Adam? Wherever you go to the daycare, you don't find Adams over there. You go to the school system, Adams are missing. You go to the stores, Adams are missing. You go to the house of God, Adams are missing. You go to the homes, we have a lot of young men and women who have missing fathers. Adams are missing. And the same thing happened on this particular morning. Early in the morning, after the tragedy, after everything was questioned and done, you expect that you find the figureless guys like Peter and other disciples that were with Jesus to be the first to be present at the tomb. But Adam was still missing. It's my prayer at this church. May we have Adams in this house come back to life today in the name of Jesus. I declare that I will be the spirit of the Father in this house. I declare that we'll have Father figures in this house. I declare that Adam will be the front line in the name of Jesus. I declare that Adam will be the head in the name of Jesus. Because it's a tragedy and a cry of our generation because Adams are missing. You go to the prison for those people who work in the prison. You find all these young men and women who are there. One of the things most of them they have in common, they say they grow up in a family where there's no father figure. Either the dad was not there, was not physically present, or the dad was not even emotionally present. Because you can be there physically present, but are there emotionally present? Adams. Praise the Lord. Amen. You can be there watching TV. You can be there reading newspaper. You can be there visiting things, but you are not present. Am I preaching to somebody?
Yes.
I pray that God will help the Adams in the house to be present. And the Bible says that these women, Mary Magdalene, they went there and they saw the tomb has been moved. The stone was moved. Even they were wondering who going to move the stone for them. But the Bible says, they both ran together to the other disciples, outran Peter, and came to the tomb fast. And that's amazing because I thought that Peter was so fast. Even with the event of cutting the ear and everything, I would think that Peter was fast, but these women, they had planned Peter, and they came to the tomb fast. And verse number 5 said, he stooping down and looking in, they saw the linen cloth lying there, yet they did not go in. Then Simon Peter came following him and went to the tomb, and he saw the linen lying in there, and the handkerchief that has been around his hand, laying with the white cloth, but folded together in a place by itself. I want you to see the picture that they saw. Amen. Then the other disciples who came to the tomb first went in also, and he saw and they believed. What did they do? They saw
and they believed.
I want you to note that. They saw and they believed. Amen. For as they did not know the scripture that he must rise again from the dead, the disciples went away again to their own homes. Even as they saw and they believed, they just went to their own home. They didn't even know what else to do. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
But I want you to look something that I want you to leave. I want you to say something here. And verse number 12 says, and she saw the two angels. This was she saw the two angels in the white city, one at the head and the other at the feet, where the body of Jesus had laid. And they said to her, woman, why are you weeping? She said to them, because they have taken away my Lord, and they do not know where they have laid him. Do you see how the women are? Even when the men, even when the disciples went back home, the women were left at the altar crying and weeping. They were left weeping at the altar. It's my prayer for the women in this house that we may take our position. That when things are going out, whoever there, instead of you doing things and doing other things, come to the altar and weep and cry unto Jesus. This is your praise. Women, this is your praise. When everything is not working out in your life, you may try so many other things and they are not working. Come to the altar, cry, weep, and the Lord himself will give you the answer, because you are told, actually don't weep, because you are looking at the living among the dead. Revelation will come when you come to the altar. Revelation appears when you are in the altar. You cannot find revelation on WhatsApp groups. You cannot find revelation on Facebook. You cannot find revelation on Instagram. All those things that you know, those are not a presence for revelation. The revelation is at the altar, somebody. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. I pray that the Lord Almighty will raise people who knows the revelation is at the altar. And when things are not working out for you, instead of asking so many people out there, come to the altar and you receive your revelation. Amen?
Amen.
And Jesus, you all know the story. He was not in the grave anymore. He is selected and he went. And I want you to go with me. I'm finishing now. If you go to the book of Luke, I want to show you something very interesting. What Luke account for. Thank you, Jesus. The book of Luke, chapter number 24. I want to show you when he is selected. Moving somewhere, hallelujah. Chapter number 24 and verse number 30. You see that there are two people that were walking to a city called Emmaus. And when they were walking, they were talking about the event that had happened in the entire week. About the death, about how they did Jesus, how they crucified him. And they were so upset. All this comes from 24. If you see verse number 25, it says, he said to them, so Jesus came and he joined those two strangers that were walking. One of the gospel called one of the guys was, his name was Cleopas. And he said to him, O foolish ones, and slow of heart to believe in all the prophets have spoken. Or not the Christ have suffered all these things, have entered into his glory. So he started talking to them. And he was just telling them and explaining to them. And when you come to verse number 30, they came together after they talked. They sat together at the table. Because it was a 7-mile walk. So they sat at the table. And they broke the bread together. And verse number 30, I want you to see what happened. That now it came to pass, as he sat at the table with them, that he took a bread, blessed, and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened. And they knew him. And he vanished from their sight. Praise the Lord. They've been walking with him for 7 miles and talking. And they were talking about what happened. They were sad. And everything was that has happened. And he kept on asking them questions. He told them about the story about what happened from the Genesis. He continued to tell them about the promises and everything that has been saved. And they did not know that it was Jesus. And this guy, Cleopas, was asking so many questions. And he continued to answer all the questions. They were talking about the Passover, but they did not know that they were in the lap of Passover with them. And finally, when they sat down at the table, and they broke the bread, and he blessed the bread, and he gave them, when they ate, their eyes were open, and he vanished from their sight. And they said to one another, did not our hearts burn within us when he talked with us on the road and when he opened the scriptures to us? So they rose up that very hour and returned to Jerusalem and found the 11, because now they were not 12, because Judas had disappeared. And they found the 11, those who were with them, and they gathered together and they said, the Lord is risen indeed. He has appeared to Simon. And they told him the thing that happened on the road. And he was known to them in the breaking of the bread. Praise the Lord. There's a power when you break the bread. And that's what Jesus did. Because at this particular time, he knew that he was the bread of life. And he knew that he had to break that bread together so that the scriptures can be fulfilled. Praise the Lord. And as we come to the end of this service today, on this Easter Sunday, we are going to do exactly like what Jesus did. He was with the disciples at the Passover, and they ate the bread together. And then when he appeared to this pastor, to these guys on the road, he gave them the bread, and their eyes were open. Amen. So I'm going to ask my brother to bring, we're going to have the bread. Amen. We are going to partake the Holy Communion as we wind up this service together. In Jesus' name, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. JICC, as we gather here today on Easter Sunday, I want you to remember this sacrament of the bread and the blood of Jesus. Today, I want you to take the communion with revelation that the bread represents the body of Jesus. And the wine represent the blood of Jesus. So when you are taking this, you are asking yourself, you are searching yourself, and you are acknowledging that today Jesus died and he rose again for you. The power is not in the bread, but the power is in the revelation that is behind the bread. The power is not in the wine, but the power is in the revelation behind the wine. Because when you know the revelation behind why you're taking the Holy Communion, it teaches you to humble yourself. It teaches you to acknowledge the Lord as a Lord and a Savior. And so this is a very serious moment. And before we partake the Holy Communion, Paul said in the book of 1 Corinthians that it is good for you to evaluate yourself before you come to the table. And I'm going to ask each and every person who is hearing my voice in this house to take 1 minute, evaluate yourself, and repent of every sin or everything that can hinder you from taking this communion. Go ahead and go before God and just pray. Evaluate yourself and repent, because we are just about to enter into a Holy Communion. Father, in Jesus' name, we repent of all our sins, O God. As we enter into this communion, O God, young and old, Father Lord, we've all come from different backgrounds, O God. We've all come from different homes, O God. But today, Father, we are gathered here at your feet, O God. We know we are not worthy to partake this, O God. But Father Lord, because of your mercies, because of your grace, O God, we pray that you may enable all of us, O God, to partake into this Holy Communion, O God. And as we partake the communion, I pray for your healing power to flow of our life. I pray for your restoration power to flow in our life. I pray for breakthroughs, O God, in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, we give you glory. We give you honor. Oh, we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to continue with the worship. And our elders will pass the bread to each and every one of us. And do not partake. We are going to do it together. You just hold it until I'll tell you. So let's go ahead. total humility, this is a feast that we have here as a church. And I call it a feast because the feast of Passover was celebrated, and the blood was representing the flow of them all the way from Egypt. And they also took the wine that was also the significant of the Passover. But now when Jesus came, he stood as the bread of life. And his shedding of the blood of the cross, it represented the blood that he shed on the cross. So when we come here, church, to feast on the feast of Passover, the sacrament, we are empowering our body one more time. And we are asking the blood of Jesus to cleanse our life forever. We are releasing the healing of our bodies as we eat the blood, because the blood